Funding for this program was provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. Additional funding was provided by Cherry Sky Films and the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum.
Am I a real enemy of the cross? Or a very sorry saint?
You just didn't have any idea.
I mean, I don't know.
I don't know.
I don't know.
I don't know. I really don't.
What the old janitor did in this room, no one knew. It was a place he kept to himself. Only upon his death in 1973 did anyone discover the work. Thousands of pages of writing, journals, and autobiography. And at more than 15,000 pages, perhaps the world's longest novel. Hundreds of paintings, many of them over 10 feet long. But Henry Darger left behind only three pictures of himself.
I tell you, I don't think many people even noticed him, you know. He didn't pay too much attention to him.
He was, to me, an ordinary, a very poor ordinary man.
No, I just thought he was a poor old guy, you know, quite a recluse. Lived in his own world.
It seemed like he was in a world by himself.
Henry was just in his own little world.
In his own little world.
His other world.
He called this world the realms of the unreal.
Volume 1 of the story of the Vivian Girls in what is known as the Realms of the Unreal, of the Glandico-Angelinian War Storm caused by the Child Slave Rebellion. The story of the bravery of the Vivian Girls called Violet and her sisters. This volume, I hope I can truthfully say, has scenes and incidents which no other story of usual size in the world may contain, either in fiction or reality. Things that might be comical, sad, and horrifying. To write everything here would spoil it all for the reader. Let the reader follow every event and adventure, and then he can, if he sets his mind and heart on it, take it on as if he himself was an actual participator. The author writes the scenes in this volume as if he had experienced them himself.
He was not a tall man.
He was a shorter person.
Maybe 5'4", 5'5"?
About 5'5", 5'6".
You might take him to be a street person?
Almost like a homeless, you know. But he wasn't homeless, you know, but he was poor.
He always wore World War I army coat all the way down to the ankle.
I think he wore that most of the year.
And it was very filthy and mended all over. He mended everything. He was very ingenious. In his own way, he did everything he could to, you know, look well.
His name? Henry Darger. We all called him Henry Darger.
No, it was Henry Darger. We pronounced his name Henry Darger.
Henry Darger. Henry Darger.
I always pronounced it Henry Darger. It seemed to me that was what other people in the neighborhood called him.
Darger.
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 Once upon a time, a little boy was born.
In the month of April, on the 12th, in the year of 1892. I do not remember the day my mother died, or who adopted my baby sister, as I was then too young. My father and I lived in a small two-story house between Adams and Monroe Street. As he was lame, I bought the food, coffee, milk, and other supplies, and ran errands. My father was a tailor, and a kind and easygoing man. For Christmas, I mostly always got colored pictures or storybooks, which I only liked, and chicken for dinner. Once in a while, to paint pictures or anything else, I had paint boxes, but I myself bought them. Before I went to school, I could read already the newspapers which my father had learned me by study. Because of that, From first grade, I was promptly put up to third grade. I once told my teacher that I believed no one truthfully knew the losses in the battles of wars, including our Civil War, because each history told different losses, and I had the histories to prove it. For mistakes in school, I would have to write a sentence of words 200 times or more. One thing I must write is that us children in those days were looked on as beneath the dignity of grown-ups, whereas, to my opinion, all grown-ups, and especially all types of strangers, were less than the dust beneath my feet. I was very interested in summer thunderstorms, still am, old as I are, and during winter would stand by the window all day watching it snow, especially if there was a great big blizzard raging. I always had a very willful nature and mean temper, very determined always that all things shall come to my satisfaction or else. People say I have fire in my eyes. I would not even stand for a snowless winter. I cried once when snow stopped falling, and my poor father looked at me so queer.
By Henry's 8th year, his father was too ill to care for him. Henry's father went to live in the St. Augustine poorhouse. Henry was sent to a boys' home called the Mission of Our Lady of Mercy.
Being in the home, I was sent to a city public school called the Skinner. I was good and studious, but not meaning any harm or wrong. I was a little too funny and made strange noises with my mouth, nose, and throat, to the great annoyance of all the other boys and girls. And I thought they would think it funny and laugh or giggle, but they gave me saucy and hateful looks. Because of my silly noises, they were very much annoyed and tantalized. Some said if I did not stop it, they'd gang up at me after school. I defied them. Some of them did try to beat me up, but I knew how to defend myself with the long stick I always carried and with telling effect. My teacher had said that they still had been the best behaved children in any classroom she ever did any teaching in, and my annoying them caused me being excommunicated from the school. For other strange things I did, I was looked on as crazy. Once, my father brought some woman relative to have me adopted by her, but Father Murphy was not there at the time. My father never came with her again.
In this story, for more than 43 years, child slavery existed in the Calverinian country. Hundreds of thousands of children torn from their parents, made to work themselves to death without getting a cent, and horrors upon horrors almost equal that of perdition.
To free the children, the Christian nation of Abiania wages a 4.5-year war against the godless Glandolinian slave owners. Leading the child slave rebellion are the 7 Vivian girl princesses.
Daisy, Hetty, Violet, Joyce, Jenny, Angeline, and Catherine. Their beauty could not never be painted had they been seen for real, but their nature and ways and goodness and soul were still more pretty and spotless. They shunned evil ways not through fear of their parents, but through fear of God. They were always willing to do as they are told, going to Mass and Holy Communion every day, and living the lives of little saints. But their lives, for at least a number of years, were to be all of sorrow. Not even poor Uncle Tom and Uncle Tom's cabin suffered as they did at the hands of their cruel masters.
I do not remember the length of time I remained in the Mission of Our Lady's home, but one part of the last year, I was taken to be examined by a doctor who said my heart was not in the right place. Where was it supposed to be? In my belly? I did not know it at the time, but now I know I was taken to the doctor to find out if I was really feeble-minded or crazy. Had I known what was going to be done with me, I surely would have ran away.
By permanent segregation only is the imbecile to be safeguarded from certain deterioration and society from depredation, contamination, and increase of a pernicious element.
During a cold, windy, threatening, late November day, I was hustled onto the Chicago and Alton Limited train. and brought to some kind of home for feeble-minded children outside of Lincoln, Illinois. If I had known the cause of me being sent to that children's nut house, I sure would have never forgiven those at the mercy of Our Lady Home. I, a feeble-minded kid, I knew more than the whole shebang in that place. I was now 162 miles away from Chicago and my father. I had heard there were, at times, 1,500 children there.
The feeble-minded lack totally the innate power of development. They have little or no individuality. They would merely grow up extremely ignorant and useless. Book learning is not well adapted to the needs of these children.
When in my earliest teens, I was put with a company of boys to go and work on what was called the state farm.
For the bigger children, work begins at 7 a.m. and continues until 5 p.m., with one half-hour break for lunch. Attendants are permitted to spank, box the ears of, and paddle inmates who are disobedient.
Right now, she felt like running away herself rather than to remain here a slave. Happily, however, could be the day when her father would be coming from the house with outspread arms and running to welcome his returning child who was being brought safely home to him at last. She thought of this a long time, and that night she dreamed it and many other beautiful things. While back at the home, I received a severe shock. I got the bad news that my father died at the St. Augustine home. I did not cry or weep, however. I had that kind of deep sorrow, that bad as you feel, I could not. I'd been better off if I could have. I was in that state for weeks.
And thus she would sit without moving, silently fighting down her burning sorrow and homesickness until she was called to work again.
I believe I was at the asylum 7 years. During the early summer of the fourth year, I made my first attempt to run away. But that farm's cowboy caught me in a cornfield, tied my hands together, and made me run back all the way on the rear of his horse.
Are you not treated better in this plantation than you can ever expect as a little slave? Did you ever in your life have as nice a sleeping quarters or such good wholesome food to eat? I cannot imagine such an ungrateful little girl.
I just want to be a free kid.
Merciful heavens! The child slave has lost her mind!
During the early summer of the sixth year, two boys working on the farm induced me to run away with them. We rode on the Illinois Central to Decatur, Illinois. I again, while there, wanted to see Chicago again. You would not believe it, but I then walked from Decatur, Illinois, to Chicago, arriving early in August.
Chicago invites the visitor to discover why the world's youngest city is also the world's most cosmopolitan city. With Aladdin-like rapidity, this bustling metropolis has increased in size and importance to become a city which truly voices the greeting of the great Central West. Chicago is the greatest railway center in the world. As a grain, lumber, livestock, and packing market, it stands supreme. Some of the largest and finest civic monuments in the world are to be found here. The shores of Lake Michigan provide an ever-changing panorama of interest and recreation. Chicago, the most American of American cities, the nation's majestic mid-continent capital. Other cities are children of the past. Chicago is the heir of the future.
With no home to return to, Henry found a job as a janitor at a Catholic hospital, St. Joseph's. He was 17 years old. Working long hours under the nuns' watchful eyes, Henry's life in Chicago was far different from the one he remembered.
Many a time I scrubbed the floors of the sleeping rooms and the 100-foot-long hall of their dormitory on my hands and knees. You would say that was a good way of doing penance or humbling myself. Ha, ha. I'll still do it on my hands and knees rather than cleaning floors with a darn sloppy mop. Several times when scolding me for something, whether I did it or not, Sister Rose threatened to send me back to the Lincoln Asylum. I wish then she had. I was better off there and never was scolded. But I knew they would not take me back now, and told her so. I can't say whether I was actually sorry I ran away from the State Farm or not, but now I believe I was a sort of fool to have done so. My life was like in a sort of heaven there. Do you think I might be fool enough to run away from heaven if I get there?
Alone in the city that used to be his home, the boy found comfort in his beloved storybooks. But Henry longed to tell his own story, the ultimate story. In 1909, he embarked on the task that would consume his life, the writing and illustrating of his 15,000-page epic, In the Realms of the Unreal. Having no one to teach him, Henry had to invent his own techniques. He became a diligent collector of pictures, newspapers, magazines, and cartoons, which he clipped from the papers every day and pasted into old phone books. Over time, Henry found ways to weave some of these images into the fabric of his world, experimenting with overlay, collage, copying, tracing, whatever method was required to create the pictures in his head. In his writing, Henry appropriated bits of his favorite books, names and characters from the Oz books, passages from Uncle Tom's Cabin, the works of Dickens, Penrod.
Who is Penrod? I thought he was a story written by Booth Tarkington. Penrod? Why, Penrod is my brother.
People from Henry's boys' home days show up in the realms.
There was one boy who was somewhat friendly, and sometimes not. When he got angry at you, you knew it. His name was John Manley.
Feared leader of the evil Glendalinian. Oh, I'll get even with that long-legged, long-eared, wobbly-nosed Christian army with their short-tailed bunch of impudence.
Manley's men are often clothed in Confederate uniforms and what Darger called college professor hats. For a time, Henry had a friend to join him in the realms.
Every evening and Sunday afternoons off, I went visiting a special friend of mine by the name of William Schloeder. He was a Catholic, and so was his folks and sisters. We often went to Riverview Park. I did all the spending. If I had saved all that, what would I have had?
I know a man well who is an exceedingly dangerous foe of those who hate little children. Who is he? He lives far away in the United States of America. He is Captain Henry Joseph Darger. His friend's name is William Schloeder. The two are regular hawks. They are the head presidents of the Children's Protective Society called the Gemini. It is a lodge of men congregated who are terrible enemies of all those who do the children any kind of harm.
In the early part of September 1917, I was drafted into the Army when the United States entered the latest part of World War I. I found Army life far from pleasant. I would have, in a way, liked the Army life, only I was forced to leave behind things I loved too much. That was almost unbearable.
Henry found the war useful only as fodder for his fantasy world.
I have never been so fortunate as to have seen a battle of such savage fury as to have been brought down by a shell. Still, I have observed pictures and movies of great battles.
Though he wrote vividly of combat, Henry never left the United States.
To Captain Darger, Company L, Camp Logan, Texas, dear sir, I have learned of your ability of terrorizing
the enemies of children. We request you to come over to Abiania and do something to end the child slave horror. Yours truly, Colonel Jack Evans.
Through real bad eye trouble, which I greatly exaggerated, I received my dismissal from the Army and got my old job at St. Joseph's Hospital.
In dear old United States, a young man of sturdy build was on his way toward a three-story house in the region of St. Joseph's Hospital. He wore the garb of a captain. He was a stern-looking man, Herculean build, and tall enough to embrace 6 feet. He had a fierce visage, full of determination, and if one happened to see him looking at them, they would have felt like rushing away for safety at once.
His life actually was not that interesting. You know, it was probably a very boring life.
There wasn't that much to him.
He was just another little old man that was all by himself.
I guess as children, Henry seemed funny and different. We just thought he was funny. Entertaining, I guess.
Mary O'Donnell grew up in the Webster Street house where Henry lived. The building was owned by her family until the 1950s.
Henry never felt comfortable talking to anybody that I knew of. He did not want to speak to anybody, and he didn't want anybody speaking to him.
Nathan Lerner, an artist and educator, and Kyoko Lerner, a musician, were Darger's last landlords.
My first impression of Henry was that he was not able to relate to anything or anybody around him, surrounding him. He was all by himself, and he was very alone.
I don't think he really wanted to get too close to people. That was the impression that a lot of us felt, that we saw him on a regular basis at church. If seeing you on the street, he would just pass you by, sort of look the other way.
Henry never dealt with people. Henry paid no attention to us. As far as he was concerned, we didn't exist.
If he was aware of people, I'm sure he would be aware of people out of fear.
Obviously, he was scared. He was hurt by people.
I don't have that feeling at all. Henry never, I don't think, was afraid of anybody. Leave me alone. He would say that. Just leave me alone.
He never responded to the question you asked for. He responded with the answer like, well, storm is coming from California tomorrow night. Or a tornado is in Arkansas right now, and it's going to move to such and such place. And he never talked about anything but weather. Never.
He seemed to become unconscious of his surroundings, unconscious of everybody around him. He was somewhat sullen, and they knew from experience all words were wanton expenditure on him. They had come to regard him as many of us regard the wonders of nature, without any questionings and often without any interest.
When you go upstairs on the third floor, almost always you hear Henry talking to himself, more than two voices.
Henry only had conversations with himself. He talked in all different dialects and voices, and you'd think he had a room full of company. In fact, when people would come to visit, they would say, that man has more company than anybody I've ever known. And we'd say, no, that's just him. High, low voices, sounded like different languages at times, but what he really said, I don't remember.
Henry lived behind me in one room, and I lived in front in two rooms. The first time I went, Henry, do you have somebody back there? Because he was alone all the time, I thought maybe it might be a friend or somebody knew more about Henry. No, it was Henry himself was doing those noises, and it was like he got caught and denied it. Nobody's back here. You know, I think it was him reliving the arguments he would have with the nuns.
I hate to say it, but have to. Sister DePaul was a pain in the neck. Sister DePaul had a bulldog-like face and seemed to have the disposition of one.
I imagine they would get pretty tight with him and say, this is what has to be done, this is what has to be done.
He would say things he couldn't say during the day when he was working, and he would say, such and such, and then you hear, oh, Henry, you didn't do that.
Even coming into the house, until he got into his room, that's when he would start with all these different voices.
But he'd get in his room, and then that's where he had the power. So he was in that space, and he could argue quite well, and he would do that. That's what I think was happening. It could be as far off base as anything else.
I was not ever the talking back kind. I received that sort of training in the Bughouse Asylum. Whoever talked back to a superior there got the real punishment and how. I never talked back. I did not dare. Blessed are the meek, for they shall possess the land.
In Henry's room, he made the rules. Here he was the lord of his own realm, the realms of the unreal. Each night he entered a world where anything could happen.
One remarkable incident during the battle when heaven and earth seemed to be going to pieces was the bravery of General Darger. The cowards, to pursue innocent children with that big number, snarled Darger in a boiling rage. I won't spare a man. Then he gave the signal to his men to blaze away.
In the realms, the measure of battle is not millions or billions, but
trillions of tortured souls and demons together, and making a roar as if all of hell and the end of the world was appearing.
In the realms, children are protected by a variety of fantastic flying creatures called Blengiglominions, or Blengens for short.
Crimesian Gazunian, hideous, but a very gentle creature. Human-headed Blengens of Calverin Island. Only the angels of heaven can combat these creatures. Cat-headed Blengiglominion Gazook, or the Thunderer. They have voices like human beings, but their roar is a proverb. 10,000 times louder than the roar of the lion. Their wings make a roar like an approaching cyclone. No man is safe in their presence who harms a child. The creatures have shown a greater fondness toward children as to exceed the love of any mother.
In the realms, nothing is ordinary, not even little girls.
The little girls also had a different nature that made them seem like men instead of mere little girls. There was nothing that they could not do. They could ride the best horses. They could rise in the stirrup standing up. They can stand the coldest water and air without any clothes on.
I really don't know if he knew the difference between a boy and a girl. That's why you put penises on those little girls, because I don't think he knew the difference. That was my impression. I may be all wrong, but maybe he liked little girls. I mean, I don't know.
In terms of putting the penises on the little girls, I really, really can't. I don't know.
Well, I think he wanted to put both sexes in one person. Very pragmatic.
It's hard to figure out what he was thinking.
You have to ask Henry.
You have to ask Henry in your next life.
He's a very innocent kind of man.
He was like a child.
Almost like a child.
More like a child than an adult looking at children.
Children in Darger's fantasies are often unclothed. They appear content, oblivious to their state. But sometimes nakedness seems connected with punishment. The bear children bound up as if for sacrifice.
Glandalinians take children seized from homes, sacked orphan asylums and the like, and forcing off all their clothes, leave them tied to trees until nearly frozen to death. Thousands of helpless children stripped naked.
Lesson 24. The Mass is the same sacrifice as that of the cross. I go to 3 morning Masses and Communion at the 7:30 Mass every day and 1 extra Mass on Sunday afternoon at 5 o'clock, besides the 7:15 a.m. and the 8:30. And on Mondays, I go to the Miraculous Medal Novena devotions. What did you say? I am being a saint. Ha ha. I am one. And a very sorry saint I am.
He would go every day. He went every day to church. I attended St. Vincent's Church all this time that I lived here. And so I would see him at morning mass, you know, almost all the time. And he sat right up front, the front pew, followed the mass, went to communion. He sat right up front, front pew.
In the back, he was sitting in back pews because he had his own little pew in the back and nobody else would be around him.
Always in the middle. Never in back, never in front. Always by himself. I grew up in the neighborhood where Henry lived. I was an altar boy, and he came into Mass every day. I think it's significant that he always took communion. You should be spiritually pure in order to receive the sacrament. He must have seen himself as a pure soul, you know, relatively speaking. The altar boy holds a shield that protects the communion host from dropping to the floor. So I was always right there, and he always looked me in the eye. And he had a sort of sweet look, actually. I would say that he felt very concerned to do things right. He wanted to be an obedient, faithful one. That was very much the impression that he gave.
Who is God, Angeline dear? God is our Father, who is really in heaven. He knows all things and will reward all the good by taking them all to heaven.
Captain Darger had always been longing to see for once those fair creatures called the Vivian Girls. He knew, however, that to approach the Vivian Girls, he must do the same thing when preparing for Holy Communion. He must be in the state of grace, never use any profane language, like once in a while he did, and must be better in controlling his hasty temper, which he generally had. He did not feel himself worthy enough to approach these fair creatures and determined to become more clean of heart. And that night, while he laid in bed, he dreamed that he went to Abiania, saw the little girls beg him most pleadingly to end their unjust sufferings.
Help us, please.
During my youngest days, not knowing any better, I hated baby kids. It was cursed, I believe, because I had no brother and lost my sister to adoption. I never knew or seen her, or knew her name. Yet what a change came in me when I grew somewhat older. Then, babies were more to me than anything, more than the world. I would fondle them and love them. Just any bigger boy or even grown-up dare molest or harm them in any way.
I didn't think he liked kids at all. They were just in his way.
I never saw him talk to any children or, you know, any interaction whatsoever between children and him.
I couldn't imagine him taking to children. He just doesn't seem to be that type of a person. I never saw him with anyone.
He never relied to anybody, including children or babies or old people or nobody. He was just to himself.
Must gain more talent and inspiration, and to accomplish greater inspiration, must adopt children to inspire me.
In 1917, Henry petitioned the church to grant his wish to adopt a child. His request was refused.
I hate them. I hate them. I hate and I hate them. Ain't those little girls mine to protect body and soul? Can't I do what I like and make them all happy when it's my duty to do so? Who's the Glendalinian warted skunk to hinder, I wonder?
But Henry did not give up hope. He continued to save children through the pictures he found.
I remember him reading papers. He read every paper which was published, morning papers and evening papers. And also he was looking into garbage.
Once in a while, you would see him walking up and down an alley. We thought he was just going around collecting a lot of junk. We never thought he was turning it into artwork.
Though he collected hundreds of images of little girls, Henry struggled to draw them to his satisfaction, practicing on thousands of scraps of paper.
He knew he could draw and paint many kinds of pictures. He worked steadily, but tore up sketches of the Vivian girls that proved very unsatisfactory. The hasty sketching would not matter to Penrod if he could catch their beautiful, queenly, subtle, and innocent half-frightened look, and a look which was not vanity, slyness, but something more pretty, holy, lovable, dignified, and important. There is nothing yet that I have seen that is far more splendid and beautiful and sublime among all creation than the prettiest angels in pictures. Yet they're dim compared to the Vivian girls.
In the 40s, Henry discovered that by making photo enlargements of the images he collected, he could make them any size he wanted, and he could use them over and over again. Using this innovation, Henry could manipulate the characters of his paintings in limitless ways, including his favorite models for the Vivian girls. On a salary of $25 a week, Henry would spend $3 on a single photo enlargement.
He did his best, his level best, and it was not long before the features were clear enough to strike him surely as well done.
This is surely a great gift from God Himself. It is the best gift of all. The more you draw, the better you'll be able to draw. Do the best you can, and draw everything you can lay your hands on.
The story of Chicago is an American epic. It is written in her massive skyline, in the progressive spirit of her citizens. Few great cities are more associated in the world's mind with energy and success than Chicago. Chicago and railroads are synonymous, the car's constant rush and roar a part of the big city symphony. The Loop is the mighty vortex of Chicago's vast and variegated commercial life. The stockyards, a formidable field of pens and packing plants, process the lion's share of America's meats. On her spectacular shores, thousands enjoy well-earned respites from the rush of their workaday world. It's all a part of the amazing story that is Chicago, that mighty municipal mosaic known the world over for its vital, vigorous American way of life. No city anywhere is more beloved by its citizens than this magnificent monument to modern civilization. This humming hive of industry and commerce, this is a city with manifest destiny, touched from birth by some secret magic that promised her preeminence in the modern world. This is Chicago.
Over the years, Henry changed hospital jobs and apartments, all within the area of Lincoln Park. His world by day was a few small blocks, but his world at night was a growing universe.
From the start of this great war till now, 780 battles have been fought. A small battle is a great rarity, even in the region of the Blingy-Glominian Islands near the Catherine Isles. A day seldom passes without some conflict. A dashing expedition. A daring rescue. Horrors. Other adventures worth noting.
Started drawing picture August 11th, finished August 24th.
Henry continued to refine and invent his own techniques, producing paintings at a furious rate.
Started painting August 24th, finished September the 9th.
He used cheap butcher-style paper, gluing together sheets to make canvases approaching 12 feet long. He usually painted on both sides.
God, we're all Christians of the world!
Christian children!
Death to all Christian children!
Remember Abian!
Remember Abian!
To hell with Glandolinia!
To hell with Glandolinia!
a mixture of purple and gray and frightful pandemonium, surging back and forth 10 times like tidal waves of the sea, crushing one another. The roar of musketry was like a trillion raindrops on a tin-covered roof, tornadoes of cannon fire, horrible rotting of thousands of mangled dead bodies, horrified survivors, great heroism, great vandalism, great horror. No way of escape, but only death, death everywhere.
On to victory! In the name of God the Almighty!
As the boundaries of the fantasy expand, so does its complexity. To create music for the realms, Henry wrote his own lyrics to hymns and battle songs.
The cavalry forever, hurrah, boys, hurrah!
Henry kept painstaking lists of everything. Casualties, costs of the war, names of generals. Darger gave the Christian generals names like General Delight, General Greatheart, and General Gingersnap. Their Glandalinian enemies sport monikers like General Pugnose, Lord Lechery, General Smash in the Head, and General Pighead Boomer. These mortal enemies fight in battles with names like the Battle of Angeline Kittens, Cucumber Hundreds, Grand McNally, Poverty Row,
Finger Mountain, Fort Ignorance, Snowflake Gap, Pepperneck Lace, Onion City, Bristletoe Station, Jelly Creek, Googie. Evans had kept all the accounts of what the Vivian girls had suffered, and every time he would glance over the accounts, he'd almost lose his temper.
As terrible as the war becomes, the Vivian girls embrace it all as adventure.
We are about to have a thrilling time. Bloody combats everywhere, and battles raging in 10 places at once.
Why, it's just grand.
The Vivian girls pout in the face of danger and make miraculous escapes.
Go and shoot us,
cried Joyce.
We will not shut up even if you point a gun at us all day.
Before a smash in the head could realize what had happened, the little girls disappeared out of sight.
They seem to have disappeared through the earth.
Rat them brats! I never saw such slippery skedaddles in all my life.
The reason the story runs so much with little girls as the actual heroes in this warfare is because, under most circumstances, women are braver than men.
Don't you dare draw your vile sword! I'll blow your damn brains out where you stand, you demon of hell!
Manly rushed upon the little girls with the wild curse and struck poor little Jenny down. Violet struck him a blow in the eye with her pistol butt, crying,
Take that, you rascal and enemy of God, John Manly! I hate you, you abuser of our Lord!
Boys often do think that girls are sissies, but I have myself seen many girls and women who were the opposite, and men who were more scared of mice.
This war gives us a chance to show what we can do, despite being girls, while the many cowards remain home hiding under the bed. If that is not funny, I don't know what is.
The sisters' courage is matched only by their cheek.
You must be the Vivian girls. Are you not them little children, the dearest flowers of the whole world?
Flowers? Did you see us grow on a plant?
Outside of the war, the Vivian girls live in a world of strange delight. Darger sprinkled his landscapes with touches of whimsy and odd beauty.
Thank you.
there was anything wrong with Henry. I think it was an isolate. And the term schizophrenic was around at that time, but I don't really think that, not compared to schizophrenics I've seen.
He was reclusive. That does not mean he was crazy. Just something happened in his life, the abuses and things turned him off from the world, I think.
I perceived him as probably, you know, a man with mental problems and unable to put order in his life.
My father used to say that he probably was shell-shocked because he was so strange. In one way, now that I look at it, I say, well, he was just eccentric. In another way, he was crazy. But he wasn't crazy in the normal sense of the word. He had complete control of his life. He wasn't, you know, crazy off the walls or, you know, couldn't work or he could. He could do all of that. I guess if you're poor, they call you crazy. If you're rich, they call you eccentric. He was poor, so he said crazy.
Sometimes he called himself Henry Dalgarius. He told everybody he was born in Brazil. But birth certificate shows that he was born in the city of Chicago. Reality and unreality is so mixed up. You don't know what to believe. Nathan found it very intriguing, this person. He never tried to find out answers because he said, just because there's questions, that does not mean there are answers. And he took questions as a statement. Henry, I think, felt very comfortable with Nathan. He considered Nathan as a father figure in many ways. Any time he had problems, he came for Mr. Leonard and asked for it. Like one time he was raped, he came to me and said, Mr. Leonard, when is he coming back? I said, he's coming back at 5. So at 5 o'clock sharp, he knocked on the door and said, Mr. Leonard, I was raped yesterday by a beautiful 17-year-old Italian girl. And she took all my money. I had a wallet here, and while she was raping, she took the wallet and ran away.
And we're looking at Henry and we're saying, come on. You know, but the thing is we could say that, come on, he had the experience. And again, Henry was responding to that threat in the way he knew how.
That story, I think, tells so much about Henry's thinking, because the title of his fiction, Realms of the Unreal, his life was Realms of the Unreal. In his mind, whoever tried to rape him or tried to do something was a 17-year-old beautiful Italian girl.
He might have been accosted or something else, but not raped, you know, but to Henry it was rape. So his knowledge of sex might not be very deep.
What is rape?
According to the dictionary, it means to undress a girl and cut her open to see the insides.
What do you want to do? Make me sick before we go to bed?
Well, you asked what rape is.
Said the little girl.
You princesses are too pretty for a rascally Glendalinian vandal to look at. Sometimes I believe it was a mistake that you were created to be so pretty, for it makes every movement an unseen danger.
In the realms of the unreal, innocence lives in the constant shadow of danger. And with Darger's power to render beauty grows an equal ability to depict ugliness.
Said Joyce.
Listen, are those children screaming?
Those Glendalinians are crazed from drink.
Those children did those butchers no harm.
It must be an awful thing to be choked to death like that.
Don't we know it? We were often choked like that.
I wonder how it must feel to be strangled.
Your throat hurts awfully, and there's an awful tickling feeling that makes you have a desperate feeling to cough. The worst feeling is to get no air.
I must get away. I can't stand this sight. Oh dear, please God, save the rest. Oh, save them.
As a child, Henry learned to answer violence with violence.
If molested, I was a brick thrower. I had read in the Holy Bible that children were more important to God than all the grown-ups, and that it was better for a man if harming a child to have a millstone tied around his neck and be drowned in the depths of the sea.
Jenny, do you know what the slaughter of the Holy Innocents means?
The Holy Innocents, as we call the young little baby martyrs, were for him cruelly slain by Herod's soldiers.
We all of us have seen great massacres of children, and even a man won't peel that off as easy as a sock. This war is fought against everyone who is of our age. We are not children anymore. We were 8 and 10 and so on, and had begun to love life and God. The world was ours, and to defend our rights, we have to shoot it to pieces. We are cut off from heaven. Glendalini is the Cain, and we are the Adam.
By depicting the slaughter of the children, Darger can become their avenger.
It has been shocking to read all about the miseries endured by those children, and I don't approve of their writing it, though it probably was done just to arouse the world against those wicked Glendalinians.
We must save all of the children and shall,
cried the officers.
To hell with Glendalinia! She wanted war, and we'll give her hell! To hell with Glendalinia!
To hell with Glendalinia!
He wasn't hostile, or I never saw him angry.
I don't remember him getting angry at all.
He seemed to be happy enough, as far as I could tell.
He was always the same. He wasn't angry, he wasn't happy, he was always the same.
Sneered Gertrude Angeline.
If I was transparent, you would see instead of an exquisite red heart in my breast, a rolling cloud of fire. That's how much I hate the foe.
But some days the question looms. Who is the foe?
In my younger days, when angry over something, I burned holy pictures and hit the face of Christ in pictures with my fist. That was my temper then. Yet I am not that way to persons, only all sorts of gadgets and other things. If something I'm working on goes wrong, I am a spitting, growling, if not thundering, volcano. And do I say bad words and blaspheme? Oh my. It says in the Holy Bible, for those who do not bear the cross, there is no salvation. I'm sorry to say, I defied that and still do.
Though the Christians fight a holy war, Henry sometimes questions whether God is on their side. Early in the writing of The Realms, Henry lost a newspaper photo of a murdered little girl named Elsie Parabek. In the world of the Glandico-Angelinian War, Elsie Parabek became child rebel leader Annie Ehrenberg, and the recovery of her picture became Henry's obsession.
Picture of Annie Ehrenberg gone, mysteriously missing.
I'm Annie Ehrenberg. I was cruelly murdered because I was the leader of the rebel children. You alone have the situation of both sides in your power. I appeal to you to avenge my assassination.
I answered that I would do my best, but that I must under any conditions recover the picture first.
Henry begins a long process of petitioning God.
Picture of little Miss Annie Ehrenberg taken from Chicago Daily News of June, May, or July. Petition for return of same said picture was requested sometime in March 1915. Erecting mimic altar to pray before in order to obtain petition. Making the mimic chapel neat and clean, no matter how much work. Buying materials of all sorts for shrine. Read Bible every evening and say all the litanies when shrine is finished.
When God does not intervene, Henry predicts ruin for the Christians in the war.
Because of Ehrenberg mysteries, Vivian girls almost fatally injured. Petition must come by end of month to save Christians.
This is all on account of that Darger and his old picture.
How is it that the loss of the photograph is responsible for the situation of this war?
Asked General Viviana rather hotly. That is a mystery, Your Excellency, even to me.
Do you pray for the recovery of the stolen picture?
I have tried various means. Invaded the Glendalinian public libraries, without success. As it is fair in war, I would have seized the newspapers the picture was in, but I could not trace it, though I examined book after book.
Prediction and threat. Campaign of Christians being broken. Christian armies receiving blows after blows, foes sweeping all before them.
Eddie Ehrenberg becomes the martyr in an increasingly brutal conflict.
Altar pulled down. Cain to be paid to Christian nations. No mercy will be shown. Am an enemy against the Christian cause, and desire with all my heart to see to it that their armies are crushed, and that I will see to the winning of the war for the Glandalinians. Results of too many unjust trials. God is too hard to me. I will not bear it any longer for no one.
To the dismay of the Vivian girls, a General Henry Darger appears on the side of the enemy.
I heard lots about this man. He is a Glandalinian general who serves with Manly.
Henry Joseph Darger, the old-time Gemini friend of ours, he is not a born Glandalinian. He makes himself a treacherous traitor.
Henry even vows for 3 months to cease writing altogether. Still, the picture does not reappear, and the loss deepens Henry's realization that all the power he wields in his fantasy world cannot bring him what he yearns for in the real one.
Doom, it may concern. For a certain man whose name is not to be mentioned here, since the year 1917, he had constantly prayed for a means of adopting little children. The petition is called by priests, one of the most worthy ones on record. If so, why is it not answered? Is his threat about making the Christians lose the war if it is not answered anything to do with it? Probably. He has, for all those many years, offered novenas, said the rosary, done little acts of sacrifices and so forth, and yet receives no answer. He has been inspired by reading in books of so many favors said to have been granted to many others. Is there something holding it back? If there is, what is it?
I feel as if it is of no use to pray any longer. The Glandalinians tell me that God never listens to the prayers of child slaves, and he certainly did not listen to me.
Henry struggled with God throughout his life, but he could never wholly abandon his faith.
While working at St. Joseph's Hospital, I got on me a very mean streak because of prayers not being answered on a question over the snow. Foolishly, I stopped going to Mass, and I badly sang awfully blasphemous words at God for hours. I am surprised that God did not strike me, but no, he did not. I believe he knew there was a time coming when I would wisely change my ways. It did happen. In some sort of a magazine, I read of a young fellow who, when losing his fortune, turned bandit and robbed and killed at will. He was betrayed by false women friends, arrested, and being found guilty at his trial, was condemned to be hanged. When he died, he went to hell and was tormented horribly by fiends. There was not only descriptions of the story, but as many pictures. The pictures of his torments in the fires of hell and by the demons scared me into repentance, and I have been going to daily Mass and confession frequently, and also daily communion, ever since. Hell is a state to which the wicked are condemned, and which they are deprived of the sight of God for all eternity.
Don't believe what the wicked Glandalinians tell you. God is a loving Father to us all, and he always knows what is best for us. If we pray to him for something that is not good for us, he does not grant it, no matter how badly we want it.
Why, I never thought of that at all.
Will you tell him that you will trust him to do what is best for you so you can be a happy little girl again?
I will kneel down this minute and ask our blessed Lord to forgive me for my doubting him.
The dread soul crisis was now past. From her deepest soul, she felt a relief, and she looked up to the silent, ever-living stars, imitations of the angelic hosts who ever looked down on everyone, good or bad. And the solitude of the night continued.
Wounded by his hidden battles with the heavens, Henry seemed to resent the arrogance of those oblivious to a divine will. In 1953, he began a series of weather journals,
Weather reports truthful or contrary of weatherman's reports for winter cold, warm, and also rain, snow, cold waves, and big or small blizzards. Also summer heat, cool spells, thunderstorms, fair and cloudy days. Sunny and mild today. High 54 degrees at 10 a.m. 55 at 11 a.m. 3 a.m. to 6 a.m. 36 degrees. Noon to 2 p.m. 53 degrees. 3 to 4 p.m. 52. East winds. 8 p.m. 49 degrees.
Darger painstakingly tracked the weather each day, and he compared his notes with what the weatherman had said the weather would be.
He said showers ending today. Oh yeah, where is the showers? Why does he say showers when no rain comes? He makes a perfect fool of himself. Did not someone in heaven declare that no one can predict always the weather correctly? Yes, heaven won't permit it, the Bible say.
Henry kept track of the weather and the hubris of the weatherman for 10 years.
Forecast, early winter coming in with a roar. Chicago is in for an early winter, starting with a roar around November 4th.
For 1962 and 1963, he was wrong on all of this.
The weather most of the last 7 days turning somewhat colder just before Christmas.
Chicago, one of the great urban centers of America. This Midland metropolis is where the skyscraper was born, where people from around the world come to discover the heart of the nation. The world's busiest rail center has grown to such size and wealth that it is now also the world's busiest air center. Chicago remains not only the meat processing capital, but the foremost food processing capital too. But its heart is still the central city. Here is where the veins of commerce pulse, where economic power flexes its muscles. Chicago is also the city for R&R. An impressive system of beaches stretches almost the length of the city. This American city stands in proud tribute to the daring of the planners and the courage of the people who dared to let the dreamers build their dreams. A new urban civilization forever evolving into the city of tomorrow.
Close to 300 pieces of paintings, which are most of them both sides, 30,000 pages of written works. One of the things Nathan used to say was, when you don't have a family, when you don't have television, you don't have radio, see what one can achieve. But he didn't think Henry slept very much, maybe three hours, 4 hours, if he slept at all. Henry never slept in the bed. He slept on the chair.
Henry worked in menial jobs at the same Catholic hospitals until he was forced to retire at the age of 73.
I'll say it is a lazy life and I don't like it. I suppose a real lazy person would enjoy it.
Henry spent his unwelcome free time
adding to his various collections, especially twine and string. He worked on his autobiography, wrote in his journals, and continued his daily contesting with God.
Short tantrum over tangles and brown twine. Threatened ball throwing at sacred image. Always threaten, but don't do it. Disrespectful words at God. I'm a hard-boiled egg, and will always be one. Still a sorry saint.
Henry's dream of adoption still lingered, in a more modest form.
At that time, we had a dog called Yuki. To Yuki, he really responded. He smiled when Yuki jumped up and down. He never called anybody else's name except my dog. And at one point, Henry said, how much it costs to keep a dog. So I said, oh, maybe $5 a month. He shook his head and said, oh, that's too much money for me. But he really loved my dog. I think he wanted something to share his love with. He never had.
Henry's old pal, Willie, had moved to Texas with his sister in 1956. He was the only friend Henry had to lose.
My dear friend, Miss Catherine Schloeder, I surely did not feel at all good about it when I received the very sad news that my dear friend Bill died Saturday. I feel as if lost in empty space. He was like a brother to me. Now nothing matters to me at all, and I am going to hereafter live my kind of life. For our suffering in this life, I almost hate Adam and Eve, for they are responsible, for their sin is the cause. Your friend, Henry Darger. Blessed are those that mourn, for they shall be comforted.
Henry was left with the only companions he knew.
He was not shuddering anymore. He did not feel alone in the darkness and the smoke. He felt relief, as if the coming of heaven itself. He felt he belonged to them and they to him, that all shared the terror and the same life, that the boy and girl comrades were nearer and dearer to each other than even lovers. He could bury his face in any of them, in those voices, these words that have finally saved him, and which would stand by him.
They have been my companions. They are a part of myself, those pictures. Long before I knew them, I have been such a lonely little boy.
Do you believe it? Unlike most children, I hated to see the day come when I will be grown up. I wish to be young always. I am grown up now, and an old lame man, darn it.
Suffering the trials of poverty and illness, Henry was helped by his neighbors. The learners looked out for him, even reducing the rent as a Christmas present for Henry. David Berglund fed him meals, took him on hospital visits, and helped him bathe.
His support network was two or three people, and when he really had to say, I'm needy, that must have been hard for him, extremely hard.
Henry tried to continue his work, but his eyesight was failing.
From Friday 1970 till Monday 1971, everything I did was the same, including writing a fictional story of a huge, huge twister called Sweetie Pie and the unbelievable horror it did. Never had a good Christmas all my life, nor a good New Year. And now, resenting it, I am very bitter, but fortunately not revengeful, though I feel I should be. Though they were small ones, I have committed sins because of these trials, disappointments, and things going wrong, and especially all sort of childhood pain and misery.
God did not answer Henry's prayers, but did Henry answer those of the Vivian girls?
Were Violet and her sisters rewarded for their patient suffering for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ? Victories were coming in now for the Christians in endless and quick succession. All efforts were being made to capture General Manley. The children cheered. Their Christmas sorrows would soon be over.
Violet and her sisters missed nothing during the great conflicts. They were sitting motionless for hours, but their faces and eyes were dancing with some strange delight. They seemed wrapped up in some seventh heaven of childhood, a place few children reach. You had better come and see the little girls before their happiness slackens.
Demand after demand had been sent by wireless to General Manley to surrender.
Don't ask me to surrender, you dirty Christian curs. Why in hell don't you come and take me? I'm ready for you any time.
I, for one, am for the annihilation of the Glandolinians, if the crazy boob won't surrender.
We've got to end this war before it lasts forever.
Violet and her sisters are more tired of this darn war than we are ourselves.
Led by the great Christian general Jack Evans, the Abianians close in on their nemesis, John Manley.
Evans' men cut down trees behind him, blew up bridges, and ravaged the country behind. But on the Glandolinian general went, spreading terror for 1,000 miles.
But finally, the wicked enemy is cornered.
It was evident, all right, that General Manley could not escape.
Manley surrenders before Emperor Vivian.
For all I have done, I do ask pardon and will refrain hereafter from further bloodshed. I now realize how wicked I was and intend to repent if God will forgive me.
The Christians prevail, or do they? On the next page, Darger writes a similar but opposite version.
Evans' men cut down trees behind him, blew up bridges, and ravaged the country behind. But on the Glandolinian general went, spreading terror for 1,000 miles.
But this time it is Evans who is cornered.
It seemed evident, all right, that General Evans could not escape. Of all disasters to the Christian armies, this is the worst. Within another month, Manley had obtained a new, more immense series of armies and had cleared the whole country of Glandolinia of Christian forces in the most disastrous of any routes ever known in war before.
Why the double ending? Did the author have second thoughts? Did he not believe in happy endings? Or was he simply following the example of the God he knew?
For all of us who survive, we shall march our dead comrades beside us. The years of this unusual war behind us. Against whom? Against whom?
At the end of 1972, the Lerners helped Henry move into St. Augustine's, the same Catholic poorhouse his father had died in.
The nuns around him were so happy, and Henry was like, he needed help, so he threw him back to the nuns. God, you know, you just think about those things.
Henry faded quickly.
The warmth of that room, the scent of it, was all gone.
You see, the moment he left his world, his life was gone. The world he created, that was his life. And the moment he left that behind, his life was behind.
When the Lerners began cleaning out Henry's room, they discovered the work.
And then it was just awe.
I was shocked. Everything that came out, the paintings, the books, it all, it shocks me. It absolutely shocks me.
I was overwhelmed. The volume of written works with the size of the paintings and the volume of it, that was my first impression, overwhelming. When Nathan saw the paintings, he knew they were special. He said, his colors are fantastic. His composition is wonderful, but he didn't know what to make of it. See, the subject was so strange.
Henry's neighbors visited him during his final weeks.
Went in and I said, Henry, he turned around and looked up and says, seen some of your artwork in the room, and it's beautiful. And he just kind of, like, his eyes got white, and it's like, sucker punch somebody. You hit him in the stomach, and he gasped a bit. And he just looked up, and he says, "Too late now."
He wanted the quiet rapture again, the breath of desire that arose as he had looked over his best books, the quick joy of having good times of his babyhood days. Once he had had such desires, but they did not return now. They seemed to him to belong to another world. Even if these scenes of his younger boyhood days were given back to him, he did not believe he would really know what to do. It would be like gazing at a photograph of a dead comrade. The days they spent together take on a mournful life in the memory, but the boy himself surely is no more. He felt he and everyone were forlorn like children without homes, without parents, and experienced like old men, that he and they were crude and sorrowful and superficial. Lost and lost forever.
On April 13th, 1973, one day after his 81st birthday, Henry Darger died.
I try to see how he aged. He would have been an exceptional young person. Nobody was there to see it.
Obviously, his personal life was a very sad one, very lonely one. But in inner life, I can't imagine anybody had a richer life than he had.
I guess it's, Henry will always be a mystery.
It has been a comfort to me to sit and watch the Vivian girl princesses. Their graceful ways, their beauty and strangeness have helped me to understand the mystery in little girls which all the books about them cannot make clear. Though we may bend over them year after year and grow old over them, old in age and old in spirit. They did love me, and I love them.
Why, this is very extraordinary. Every picture seems to look you straight in the face as if you had some secret to tell them. Probably he had them to use as company as he was childless.
Maybe that is so, and he wanted them all to look as if they were paying attention to him.
He must have been a very odd man.
He certainly did make a good history of the Glencoe-Abianian War, and an account of everything that you little girls went through.
Is that true? He certainly is a wonderful man. We ought to try and find him.
If this immense story ever gets published, the whole world will know the history of this awful battle in the main. But its best and fullest details, it will never know.
The end.
Funding for this program was provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. Additional funding was provided by Cherry Sky Films and the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum.